Welcome. In today's class, we'll see another application of the engineering Bernoulli equation. Again, very relevant to our situation, application to stenosis in an artery, the narrowing in an artery, which can cause diseases, circulatory diseases, heart disease, and so on and so forth. So we're going to see how we can apply the engineering Bernoulli equation to one such situation. Okay, interesting, isn't it? We're going to apply it to an artery and a reduction in the diameter due to buildup of plaque or something like that. Let us look at it again from the point of view or with a problem as a backdrop that gives you a certain framework to look at it. Stenosis or narrowing of the arteries can cause health difficulties, especially cardiac related ones. If the stenosis happens to be at the place of expansion in the arterial cross section, other difficulties could arise. One of the difficulties is due to cavitation or gas bubble formation followed by rupture. Okay. Cavitation is a very interesting phenomenon. You might want to read about that separately. Very briefly, we all know thermodynamics, right? So, if you have atmospheric pressure in the system of interest, then a liquid will start boiling when you reach its boiling point. Okay. However, if the pressure is reduced, it will start boiling at temperatures much lower than the boiling point. Okay. You know this from thermodynamics. It's a pressure, temperature, volume relationship, and so on and so forth. Look at your PV diagram, PT diagram. That will give you an idea as to why the happening. The conversion from the liquid phase to the vapor phase happens over a range of things, depending on the pressure temperature conditions. So, if the pressure gets reduced to a reasonably low value, the liquid will start becoming a vapor at even room temperatures. Okay, even 20, 25, 30 degrees C, it will start turning out to be a vapor. And it will start becoming a vapor. Vapor, in this situation, you will have bubbles of various sizes. And those bubbles will burst. And when they burst, they release a huge amount of energy. You wouldn't believe it if I said so. That energy can cause pickling or pockets in steel. You know, that amount of high energy, high temperature, high pressure conditions are, high temperature conditions are created when a bubble bursts. So much of energy is released. Okay. So, this process of causing damage even to metal surfaces when the pressure is low because of the conversion of a liquid to a gas and subsequent bursting of gas bubbles. That process is called cavitation. Cavitation is a very difficult problem to deal with in many different situations. Any underwater movement needs to take this into account. Why? Because we know that pressure is involved there. You have the pressure in various different equations that you already seen. The pressure will vary with the flow. Under certain conditions, if the pressure falls much below a certain value and so on and so forth, this process will start happening. Vapor getting formed in the flow of a liquid itself. Okay, so that is the situation here. Here, that is relevant. One of the difficulties is due to cavitation or gas bubble formation followed by rupture. Rupture releases an enormous amount of energy that can even destroy metallic surfaces. Develop a criterion in terms of flow velocities, pressure, and areas for the concept of cavitation at the stenosis. That's what our interest is. Very interesting. Right. I've given you a figure here. So, this is the artery. The cylindrical part is the artery. Let us say that is joining a larger or expanding its diameter as it goes along here. And the buildup of plaque occurs here, narrowing the diameter here. So, this is the stenosis, the narrowing of the artery. The stenosis plane This is the pre-stenosis plane where there is no reduction in the diameter, and this is the post-stenosis plane, in this case a larger diameter. So that's the situation here. We are going to develop a criterion in terms of flow velocities, pressure and areas for the concept of cavitation at the stenosis. So let's apply the engineering Bernoulli equation between planes 1 and 2. Same way as you apply your material balance equation, you can apply your engineering Bernoulli equation, P2 minus V1 by rho plus V2 average squared minus V1 average squared by 2 plus G delta H, G delta Z, whatever, plus FL hat plus VS hat equals 0. In this case, there is no pumping as a part of the system, which is whatever we drew there. Only the from the pre-stenosis plane to the post-stenosis plane, with the stenosis somewhere in the middle. So there is no motor and so on and so forth, pump. So there is no shaft work to be taken into account. Also, this is a horizontal pipe, therefore no change in elevation, delta Z is 0. So you have this and these terms remaining. Equation 3.9.1.2-1. Friction loss here corresponds to a loss for a contraction. Okay. See, we have applied the engineering Bernoulli equation between planes 1 and 2. What are the planes 1 and 2? Which are pre-stenosis and the stenosis plane here, between here and here. Approximating this loss to a sudden contraction, it could be gradual, and we are getting an estimate by using a sudden contraction. We will get the loss factor, the Kf, to be 0.4 into 1 minus A2 by A1. This we have already seen. Therefore, the frictional loss per unit mass is 0.4 times Kf into V average squared by 2, which is 0.4 into 1 minus A2 by A1, V2 average squared by 2. Okay, you know that the velocity is taken at 0.2. Therefore, P2 minus P1 by rho plus V2 average squared minus V1 average squared by 2 plus 0.4 into 1 minus A2 by A1 V2 average squared by 2 equals 0 by substituting the various terms into the engineering Bernoulli equation. These two were already there. We just substituted this for the frictional loss term. 3.9.1.2-2. For cavitation to occur, bubbles of gas need to form or nucleation of gas bubbles need to take place. I'm going to explain the same thing again that I told you earlier so that you understand it better. Let us first consider boiling. In boiling, bubbles begin to appear when the pressure increases due to temperature increase and finally equals the atmospheric pressure. In the case of cavitation, the approach is in the other direction. From the other direction, the pressure decreases with increase in the velocity of the fluid, and when the pressure equals or becomes lower than the atmospheric pressure, the bubbles begin to form. In other words, the gauge pressure, or the difference between the actual and atmospheric pressures, must be zero for the cavitation to occur. Okay, so we have a criterion in this situation for cavitation to occur. So, P2 minus P1 equals the gauge pressure P2G minus the gauge pressure P1G. Okay, gauge pressure is nothing but the actual pressure plus the atmospheric pressure. I think it's 3.9.1.2-3. For continuity to hold, A1V1 equals A2V2, you know, the volumetric flow rate needs to be the same. Therefore, V2 can be calculated from V1, A1 and A2. 3.9.1.2-4. And we also know that the pressure and velocity are inversely related. V2 is greater than V1. You know, the diameter is lower, cross-sectional area is lower. Therefore, the velocity at 2 is greater than the velocity at 1. Therefore, PG2 equals 0 is the condition for onset of cavitation. Okay. The difference in pressure is what we are looking at. The gauge pressure difference is what we are looking at. When this equals the atmospheric pressure, then the liquid becomes a vapor, subsequent bursting of the vapor bubbles or the gas bubbles will happen, and that will cause cavitation. So we are considering the condition when this would become vapor, the limiting condition, that is the gauge pressure at 2 must be equal to 0. So if you substitute this in the engineering Bernoulli equation, we get minus Vg1 by rho, because V2g is 0, plus half V1 average squared A1 squared divided by A2 squared minus 1, okay, plus 0.4 times 1 minus A2 by A1. This is the loss term, A1 squared by A2 squared times V1 average squared. Okay. That equals 0. And that can be simplified, bringing the areas together and so on. So for taking V1 average out common, we get this Pg1 by rho minus Pg1 by rho plus V1 average squared by 2, it's common between these two. Then we take that out common, A1 squared by A2 squared minus 1 plus 0.4 A2 0.4 by 2 times 1 times A1 squared times by divided by A2 squared minus the minus here. So and 1 A2 will go, 1 A1 will go across. Therefore, minus 0.4 times A1 divided by A2, that equals 0. So we have a quadratic equation in terms of A1 by A2, 1.4 A1 by A2 squared minus 0.4 A1 by A2 minus 1 equals Pg1 by rho times 2 divided by V1 average squared. We can further simplify this. This is just taking this to the other side and equating it to 0, effectively subtracting this term from both sides. And solution provides a condition in terms of A1 by A2 for cavitation to occur, because we arrived at this relationship providing the conditions for cavitation that the gauge pressure at 2 must be equal to 0. So this gives you the criterion for A1 by A2. In other words, how low, how small should A2 get for the cavitation to occur? So some details, A1 by A2, this is a quadratic equation. Therefore, minus B plus or minus B squared minus 4AC divided by 2A is your variable A1 by A2. And that turns out to be, if you simplify in terms of this, 0.4 plus or minus square root of 0.16 plus 5.6 times 2 Pg1 by rho V squared plus rho V1 average squared plus 1, just switch the order, divided by 2.8. And if A1 by A2 is greater than this, okay, or A2 reduces, so that A1 by A2 becomes greater than this value, which is this 0.4 plus or minus square root of 0.16 plus 5.6 times 2 Pg1 divided by rho V2 average V1 average squared plus 1 divided by 2.8. When A1 by A2 becomes greater than this, then P2G would be less than 0 and cavitation would occur. PG2 would be less than 0 and cavitation would occur. Good. We use the engineering Bernoulli equation to get an insight into the cavitation phenomena in arteries. I'm sure that must have felt exciting. When we meet next, we'd look at another application of the engineering Bernoulli equation. See you then.